Live from Washington, I'm Aisha Tanzeem, and you're watching Access Point. Hello and welcome. The votes are still being counted in Afghanistan. Two candidates, former Foreign Minister Abdullah Abdullah and former World Bank official Abdul Ghani, have unofficially emerged as frontrunners. If no one gets 50% of the votes, there will be a runoff. Whoever becomes the next president faces many challenges. VOA's Sharon Bain highlights the top issues.
Normally, hundreds of thousands of dollars change hands here, but concerns over the future have drained the market of dollars. Najibullah Akhtari, the head of Kabul's money exchange union, says everyone is worried.
In the last 6 months, the number of dollars in circulation has dropped about 90%. Our businessmen are carrying their money out of Afghanistan to Dubai and other cities.
Cutting a security deal with the United States to prevent the withdrawal of all U.S. forces by the end of the year will be vital, says Fred Kagan of the American Enterprise Institute in Washington.
I think there's a lot of concern among women, among young people, among the more urban, modernized Afghans who have benefited from peace and from international support. I think there's a lot of fear that if President Obama chooses the zero option, which is to say withdraws, that things could become very bad indeed.
Activists fear women's rights are quickly eroding. They say despite campaign promises, none of the candidates have shown particular interest in women's rights. They fear a deal with the Taliban will further erode the position of women. Political reconciliation with the militants is seen as the only way to end years of violence. For that to work, neighboring Pakistan, which has ties with the Taliban, has to be on board. Analyst Andrew Wilder with the United States Institute of Peace says the leading Afghan candidates acknowledge that.
The whole regional thing is going to be critical moving forward. I mean, I think it's long been recognized that this conflict is not just restricted to Afghanistan. It does have strong regional dynamics.
But the most immediate worries in Afghanistan are the candidates themselves, says Jandad Spingar, head of the Free and Fair Election Foundation of Afghanistan.
Most of these candidates have a lot of supporters among people, among army, among police, among government. So you can imagine if one of them, especially these strong candidates, one of them not accept the result, what will happen? Of course, their supporter will come on street and will protest.
That kind of upheaval, some believe, could lead to even more conflict in this already violence-ravaged country. Sharon Bain, VOA News, Kabul.
Joining us in the studio are two Afghanistan experts. Jason Campbell is a policy analyst with the RAND Corporation, and Ahmad Majidyaar is a senior research associate with the American Enterprise Institute. Welcome to Access Point. So let me start with you, Ahmad. Of all the issues Sharon mentioned, which do you think will be the biggest ones?
I think that we are having election at a very critical juncture. It's the time that most of the foreign troops are set to leave Afghanistan by year's end. And also, we will notice a dramatic decline in foreign funding to the government. So the next president has very big challenges to deal with. And first of all, that would be security. Of course, the Taliban was not able to disrupt the election process, but the terrorist group still remains a very strong force to be reckoned with. People are talking about the reconciliation, but the reconciliation process has not worked over the past years. And now that foreign troops are leaving, the Taliban has even less incentive to lay down arms and make peace. And the second big challenge is the economy, because the Afghan economy, about 90% of the local economy depends on foreign funding. So the Afghan economy will suffer a lot. There will be more unemployment. And as these problems just emerge, more people might turn to more illicit ways of finding an income. The drugs problem could become even worse. So there are big challenges ahead.
Okay, so you mentioned the top two, security and economy, as many analysts say. Jason, I want to find out about security. One of the things a lot of people are saying is the Taliban were not able to mount a spectacular attack. But I read something else that Michael Kugelman wrote, which is that the Taliban probably held back. And the reason is that they're probably thinking they may have to deal politically with this government in the future. They may want a role in the future. They've tried to put a soft face and tried to manage their image. They've supported the polio campaign. So what do you think?
I think both things were in play here. I think that there are certainly pragmatic voices within the Taliban that have shown a willingness over the years, particularly since the establishment of the High Peace Council, that they are willing to talk and negotiate and try to at least discuss how the Taliban could play a more productive role in Afghan society going forward. But there are also certainly some other factors involved, not least of which are internal dissension among members of the Taliban as to whether or not they want to discuss peace with the current government. We might see another opportunity here if there is a peaceful changeover. And you also have the whole issue of the leadership, where they stand, and really where they are located in Pakistan, and to what extent they're in a position to speak for the movement writ large and be at a point where they can make decisions that are going to be followed throughout the country.
Is it possible, Ahmad, that Pakistan may have put some pressure on the Afghan Taliban, given that they still seem to have influence, and said, do not disrupt these elections. We want you to be part of a future government?
In the 2004 election, Pakistan played a very positive role in closing the border for the elections. But it did not do that in the 2009 election. That's why we had more security incident in 2009. In this election, some reports suggest that there were closer cooperation between the Afghan security forces and also the Pakistani security forces. I would not agree totally with the assumption that the Taliban held back and did not do anything. There were more than 1,000 Taliban attacks on the election day. Most of them, either the suicide bomber killed themselves, or they were not able to just conduct a very spectacular attack. Dozens of people were killed. And even prior to the elections, the Taliban conducted very high-profile attacks in the capital, Kabul. They attacked also the election headquarters and also the police headquarters in Nangarhar province and so many other parts of the country. So I wouldn't say that the Taliban held back. In conventional terms, the Taliban has never been very much powerful to fight the coalition force or the Afghan forces face to face.
Yes, and I get it that the Taliban security forces did a very good job. But in the past, the Taliban have been able to penetrate some of the safest areas. I mean, they've been almost able to attack at will within the green zone. So why this time were the security forces that effective?
Well, I think by all accounts that the security forces performed very well. But I also agree with Ahmad that it would be very overly speculative to say that the relative peace we saw on election day, at least insofar as the Taliban wasn't able to, in a coordinated manner, disrupt the elections. I think a lot of that may have come from internally and also from perhaps some Pakistani influence, because we know that certain senior members are living in Pakistan, and that it's for better or for worse that senior officials within Pakistan do have some influence over them. So I think it's fair to say that there was some influence there.
Okay, so let's come back to the candidates. Another issue that was mentioned is acceptance of the results. Now, everybody's saying they'll accept them, but also we see the front runners, at least Mr. Abdullah Abdullah and Mr. Abdul Ghani, both announcing that they've won. They've both won over 50%. So do you see any problem there, Ahmad?
I think that the problem could emerge. That depends on the findings of the Election Complaints Commission and how they address the allegations of fraud that they have received. I don't think that any of the candidates has received 50% of the vote. But both candidates have also said that they are ready for a runoff. But I think that the bigger challenge would be in the runoff, because we will have only two candidates and one of them will be announced the winner. And especially if the margin of the difference between the two candidates is very much slim, then the losing candidates might not accept the result, and that could lead to a crisis.
Okay, so that could be a security crisis, because both of them seem to have warlords on their sides. I mean, we have Mr. Ashraf Ghani with Dostum, Abdurrashid Dostum, and also. So what kind of problem do you, both of you, starting with you, Jason, see if the runoff margin is very small?
Well, I think certainly there's going to be some level of discrepancy there. I think it's unhelpful that you have two sides proclaiming victory now that you're essentially setting up each constituency for a letdown eventually, because only one of them is ultimately going to be correct. At this point, I don't see either of the the former warlords or current or former warlords involved on the tickets immediately going to arms as a result of a result that they don't like. I think it's going to, as Ahmed said, depend on the complaints and the degree to which they're investigated. And I think there will be some, I think, discussions behind closed doors, let's say, amongst the front runners here going forward to come up with some agreement as to what they could do peacefully before they get to a point where violence is.
So a joint formula could be in the works? I mean, if one of them wins, the other could become a very senior member of the executive or the government, Ahmad?
There have been discussions over the past two to three days, and some of them reportedly have been mediated by the government. To convince both Mr. Ghani and Mr. Abdullah to forge a coalition government, but none of them accepted the proposal, and they said that, no, there should be a clear winner to the election. But in the second round, especially if the process is very much troubled, and if one of them does not accept the result, I think that there is a possibility that with some mediation, either by the government or by the international community, that these two sides can come together.
Maybe they should call President Barack Obama and Secretary of State Hillary Clinton.
There are even discussions about changing the political system to change it to a more parliamentary system, so one can become president and then the next person can become prime minister.
Prime minister or the opposition leader, but with a lot of power. How so the top issues, let's come back to them, security and economy. How different are the two top candidates, Jason, in terms of how they see these issues and how they'll handle them?
I think when you start drilling down on the main issues, it's hard to see a lot of daylight between the front runners. I mean, they're all, when you looked at their platforms or looked at their campaign speeches, it was essentially a laundry list of the various issues that need to be confronted, and certainly more so beyond 2014 as the international presence and investment in the country is set to deteriorate a little bit, or at least a little bit. I think they all understand that security is number one, assuming first that you get to a peaceful transfer of power and maintaining, I think, relations with the West. I think you go to the BSA agreement. I think all candidates are in favor of and understand that's a necessity if you're going to maintain the relationships you need to keep the security forces growing and sustaining beyond this year. And from the economic standpoint, it's a matter of a lot of issues. One is maintaining international aid, but the other is sort of building a more, a just society where you're going to be able to attract the foreign investment that is ultimately going to be the real driver of economic growth in Afghanistan.
Do you think it'll make a difference, Ahmad, that one of them is a former World Bank official and seems to be an economy guy, talking about Mr. Ashraf Ghani?
I think that's Mr. Ghani's background, especially in the World Bank and also as finance minister. That attracted a lot of young voters, especially in the capital, Kabul, and major provinces, too. But unfortunately, it's difficult to realistically assess their economic plans because they have not published any detailed economic plans. And they have talked about their economic plans in very vague and general terms, of course, in the televised debates. But just only from that, it is difficult. And even in the televised debates, their economic plans seems to be very much unrealistic given the shrinking of the international funding because of the GDP of Afghanistan, that, for example, linking the country to all major economic hub in Europe and in the Middle East and Central Asia. It's unrealistic. So that was only the election slogan. But the real economic plans of them, of course, will be different.
Speaking of the candidates in terms of the regional perspective, how do they see India and Pakistan, and how will they balance the relationship? Let's talk about the two top contenders.
Sure. I think when you look at Abdullah, I think certainly his prior association with the Northern Alliance might cause a little more heartburn in Pakistan than someone like Ashraf Ghani. I think, however, they both have a very realistic view of the region and I think understand the balance very well. I think now where we're at, now 13 years into the post-Taliban period, this issue of having sort of this love, I don't say love-hate, but having this contentious relationship or tumultuous relationship with Pakistan, I think is somewhat ingrained in all Afghan politicians. They all, at one time or another, have helped to blame Pakistan for some of the issues confronting the country. And as far as India goes, I think they understand that that they are a valued ally and partner, but they also do figure into the ultimate balance that they're going to have with their neighbor to the east in Pakistan.
Some analysts say that one of the reasons why Pakistan was so willing to support the Afghan Taliban was because Karzai made it very clear that he was closer to India and didn't really like Pakistan and was an Indian friend. How important will be for the next president to keep a good relationship with Pakistan and kind of balance the India as a friend versus Pakistan that somebody we have to deal with? How important is that balance?
As I followed the campaigning season, the leading candidates did not raise a lot of anti-Pakistan rhetoric. That's despite the fact that anti-Pakistan sentiment is very much pervasive in the Afghan society, and that could have earned these candidates some votes. And that's because they understand the realities in the region, that Pakistan is a major player. Although India and Afghanistan have had very close relationship, but India is not Afghanistan's neighbor. It is Pakistan, and Pakistan's influence, both in terms of establishing peace in Afghanistan and also destabilize Afghanistan even further, is much more. So that's why both Mr. Abdullah and also Mr. Ghani, they have had talks with the Pakistani officials over the past months. And they have mentioned in their televised debates, too, that they want to improve relations with Pakistan, not to make it worse.
So how does that factor into the Afghan Taliban wanting a role in the government, whereas those other two improving the relationship with Pakistan? Do you think the Taliban at this time are worried, and what might their strategy be?
I think the Taliban are probably less worried than perhaps the Pakistanis. I think that if by some chance that the current or the new Afghan government were able to come to some agreement with the Afghan Taliban, all of a sudden, that's going to put a lot of pressure on Islamabad to be able to reach an agreement with the Taliban issue that they have within their own borders, as we know that talks are ongoing now. And it also might shift the focus or the onus on them more so than they'd like. So it's going to be touch and go, I think, for a while here. And it's certainly why you've got some senior Afghan Taliban officials living in Pakistan. I think Pakistan, in one way or another, is going to have a voice in the talks in Afghanistan. And that's going to be, I think, continually be a source of on and off tension going forward.
So let's flip the situation. Afghanistan has always alleged that Pakistan's harboring or has giving safe havens to the Afghan Taliban. But now Pakistan's saying they're safe havens on the Afghan side for the Pakistani Taliban. So how will the candidates or whoever the next president in Afghanistan be, how willing and open will he be to helping Pakistan get rid of those safe havens, Ahmad?
I don't think that this is a very right comparison, that because the Afghan Taliban, they have very extensive support network and also presence in Pakistan. And of course, there have been Pakistani militant groups crossing the border and sometimes just having sanctuaries on the Afghan border, especially in the eastern provinces of Kunar and Nuristan. But those areas are usually out of the Afghan government control. And sometimes maybe the Afghan government have tried to tolerate them in order to create a leverage against the Pakistani government. And I was in Afghanistan last time. Some security officials were saying that after 2014, if Pakistan does not stop supporting the Taliban as the only alternative, we might be able have to support some of the Pakistani Taliban, not to just like continue this proxy wars with each other, but in terms of just creating leverage to make Pakistan to either bring the Taliban to the negotiating table or to just end their sanctuaries. So it will be very much dangerous if that happened for both countries.
Did they say they'll do it in future, or did they say they've already started a little bit just to make sure that they
no,
have
they
good
said that they would do that in future, and they said that the only thing which have held that back, which have held us back from that policy have been the ISF and to a certain extent President Karzai himself. So now President Karzai is leaving and the international community is also leaving. So the Afghan government's policy could become more confrontational towards Pakistan if Pakistan does not change its policy.
Okay, so we're talking about security, and security is directly linked to economy. Since the BSA wasn't signed in time, everybody's expecting less foreign forces on the ground, which is going to impact security. How will that impact the aid coming in from outside?
Well, I think there are a couple of ways. And first, it's very hard to speculate at this point what that's going to look like. But you're right, there is an expectation that it could be a fairly significant drop. And I think the first part of it is the overall safety. And as far as putting out the money, it's having the oversight and how that money is being spent. So when you have a smaller footprint of military international troops, you have also the less ability for some of the civilians who are going out and leading some of these development projects to get out to the places where they're most in need of and to ensure that they're being carried out correctly. So I think that's the biggest threat is, first, the amount obviously is going to be somewhat tied to the number of troops you have in the country, but also the oversight component where the international community writ large is going to be less comfortable spending high amounts of money in a place where they're not going to be able to keep a very good track of how that's being spent.
Okay, so I know that the troops might be leaving, but Emma, is there any discussion on having foreign security guards, somebody like Z or Blackwater, helping those NGOs going out to places where they can monitor stuff? Have you heard anything?
The administration of President Karzai has been very much clear about that recently, that they would not accept the private security firms to stay in Afghanistan and continue their operations. And instead, he said that that responsibility should be for the Afghan security forces. The Interior Ministry should deal with that. But most of the foreign NGOs, especially the big ones, they have not accepted that because they cannot rely on the Afghan Interior Ministry. So this remains a very much debatable and heated issue between them.
But the next president might think differently than Karzai.
I think that they could reach an agreement if the Afghan government has the capabilities to provide adequate security for the international companies. They might accept that, but I don't see that in the near future. So some sort of international involvement in that respect is, I think, important. And I agree with my colleague that it also depends on the number of the U.S. forces, the residual forces who will remain in Afghanistan after 2014. Because if the number is only 2,000 to 3,000, that will be confined to Kabul, that they will not have any presence in the provinces. So that will definitely affect the international NGOs services across the country.
And another thing that might affect is the human rights situation in Afghanistan. A lot of people are fearful that human rights are deteriorating as we speak. Jason, do you think the next government, with so much on its plate, will be able to pay any attention to that?
That's a very interesting question, and at this point it remains to be seen where that's going to fit on a admittedly fairly long list of priorities going forward. There's been a lot of progress made in the last decade or so, it's not only a matter of wanting to deal with the problem, it's a matter of what resources do you have to put toward that. And I think that's going to come down probably to more at the provincial and district level governance and security. You're seeing in some provinces right now, you've got provincial governors and provincial chiefs of police and even ANA corps commanders that are all on the same page with regards to just security writ large and human rights being a part of that. If you have that dynamic, I think that's going to bode well. I think in certain areas of Afghanistan, that may not be the case, and that's certainly a risk that human rights is going to deteriorate.
If the next president is able to make a deal with the Taliban, what might that deal look like?
Nobody has talked about the details of that. Of course, President Karzai has pursued talks with the Taliban over the past years, but he has never laid down a very comprehensive plan that what the outcome of those talks, or if there is any deals with the Taliban, what that outcome would look like. Of course, the Afghan government and the United States, they had some preconditions that, for example, the Taliban should accept the Afghan constitution, they should renounce violence and cut ties with Al-Qaeda too. But even they left those preconditions as well. They became the necessary outcomes of the talks. So that has changed too. I'm not very much optimistic about reaching any peaceful settlement with the Taliban at this time, because the issue of talks is not new. President Karzai has pursued it over the past decade.
So you're expecting a civil war?
I don't see a civil war happening unless the international community completely abandons Afghanistan and also the election goes wrong and the transfer of power does not happen. I don't see the possibility of civil war, but I do see the Taliban continuing its insurgency attacks, not in terms of just coming and just capturing provinces or major population centers, because they are not able to, but they will continue their suicide attacks and spectacular attack to project power and also undermine people's confidence in the government.
So, Jason, A, do you agree with him? And B, if you agree with him, where do you see Pakistan's role in this? Do you see them continue their support for the Afghan Taliban, or do you see them hold back because the situation on the ground has changed?
Sure. I agree wholeheartedly. I think that as we reach the end of this year and go into 2015, Afghanistan as a nation is going to have to search to find a new equilibrium. And that's when you remove that many international troops out of it and the money that comes with that, there is going to be an area, a time where things are readjusting. I think that there will be a low simmering insurgency for the foreseeable future. And I think really before you get to any substantive talks with the Taliban, those members in Afghanistan of the sitting government and civil society writ large need to sit down and hash out exactly what they're willing to accept as far as the Taliban's role in a more complete governance system. And I think they're missing that right now, so you can't sit down with the Taliban right now and hash out the details because they're not agreed upon by the various actors in the current government.
Okay, so Ahmad, the second part of it, where do you see Pakistan's role?
Yeah, just related to what Jason just mentioned, that reminded me of a discussion I had with a top Pakistani security official a while ago, and he raised some legitimate concerns of Pakistan in Afghanistan, including the Indian factor. And I asked him that, well, these concerns could be, some of them are legitimate in my view, but why you do not invest in the legitimate Afghan government in terms of building your influence against India, rather than just supporting the extremists and the Taliban. He gave me a smile and he told me that, well, you believe that after 2014 this political establishment will be there. We are not very much certain about that. So the takeaway that I got from that would be that there will not be a sea change, policy change in Pakistan right now, but if this election goes well, if the transfer of power happens, and if international community stays committed to Afghanistan, and Afghanistan gradually moves towards stability, and there is no question of a Taliban comeback, I think that the policy calculation in Islamabad will change too.
So how does that play out? That's a chicken and egg situation, Jason. They will change their policy once they know the system's working, but the system is in trouble because they're not changing their policy. How do you see that working out the next 2 years?
You know, I think in a nutshell, that's been the policy for the last, since the fall of the Taliban, the Pakistan's policy in Afghanistan. And I think I agree that they're going to want to retain the option to have a voice in any ultimate discussions between the Afghan Taliban and the Afghan government. And I don't see that changing in the next 2 years. I think they will have maintained some level of influence as far as being able to perhaps turn up the pressure or you know, dial it down and have some sway over the Taliban leadership as far as what their activities are going to be, their disruptive activities in Afghanistan are going to be. But I don't see them getting in a position where they're going to see a benefit in relinquishing that control and ceding it to a greater Afghan decision or agreement in the next couple of years.
Very quickly, towards the end, Ahmad, if Abdullah Abdullah wins the presidency, what does it do for the Pashtun population of Afghanistan? Will they accept him?
I think that he will have some of the challenges. That's why it's important for him to build, perhaps include the opposition, Mr. Ghani and his team also in his government. But over the past 5 years, remember that Mr. Abdullah was a candidate in 2009 election too, he has built alliances with many Pashtun heavyweights as well. And if the election goes to a runoff, some of these even Pashtun candidates that now are running might ally with Mr. Abdullah. So he has built some sort of base in the Pashtun area, but he has to do more.
Well, thank you very much. We'll be watching the situation very closely and we'll bring you all the latest and greatest. Thank you for watching. Keep watching our shows and leave your questions and comments on our Facebook page and on Twitter. Goodbye and good night.